Hi, I'm Mo Bradley and welcome to my fly tying show. What I'm going to be doing is tying flies from ice off to ice on again, starting with the bloodworm, coronament, and these are the flies that we use in the greater Kamloops area where we have an abundance of fantastic lakes for trout fishing. What I'm going to do now is introduce you to the tools of the trade. This, of course, is a must. This is the fly vise itself, and this is what will hold your hook in there. So what we'll do, we'll put a hook in there for you. You open the jaws, and then what you want to do is adjust these to it. Say you went from this tiny little hook to a steelhead hook, which is gauge 2 wire. You would want to adjust the jaw. So I've adjusted it for a 12, a 9672-12. Now you push this all the way to there quite easily, and then you can flick it like that. If you're flicking, it rings to you. That means it's not going to fade when you're tying a fly. One of the next things you're going to need is a material clip. This is a material clip, and I'm going to stick it on there. Now this is for when you're tying multiple parts to the fly. You can stick them in here and they don't dangle and get in your way. The next thing you're going to want, of course, is a bobbin like this with a thread on it. It can be black, green, any colour you like, just depending on what type of fly you're tying. And it's easily adjustable. You want to adjust it so you can just pull it off a little tiny like that. I shove that out of the way. Now let's start on a hook. You just wrap it on top of itself, and 10 wraps is enough to get to there. Okay? The next tool, scissors. Very important that you have a point on them. Now when you're cutting something that you don't need the point, use the bottom so you don't damage that fine point. It's very important so you can get in close like that and slip it off. Okay? Now, when you get to that stage and you put the body materials on, what you're going to need is a pair of hackle pliers. Hackle pliers are just a piece of bent wire, chromed. We've got little serrations inside there to hold a feather, and you just clamp it onto the hackle feather itself, or to whatever you want it to hold for you. You wrap it round. It's better than using your pinkies because they're not quite as delicate as this. And you get in there like that, and they're called hackle pliers. You need them. There's two lots on the market. There's a real big one. It needs a bone mousse to close it and open it. So what you've got to do is get a tiny little pair like this. You don't need big ones, really. They're not necessarily that big. The next thing you need is a bobbin of some sort, a bodkin. Not a bobbin, a bodkin, you do it. Now, this is a bodkin. It's got a point on one end, and it's also got on the other end here, it's a tiny little holy. Come up here like that. I'll show you what you use a hole for. When you get to certain places on a fly, you want to tie it down. You just lap it round there like so, slip it on the end of the hook and onto the end like that. Or, better still, you use these fingers, much better tools. Round, on it, zap it. You can't forget these. On several occasions I've gone out to do fly tying demonstrations. I forgot this damn thing, so you never forget this. So what we'll do now, One more lacquer. Now this is Danville's waxed thread on here now, so it won't slip on the hook. It's a good thread, fine thread. But what you need to finish the hook off with is lacquer, so you just pop that onto the head when you've got a head on there, like that, and you stick it back in. So there's a little brush. It's from a lady who gave it to me a long time ago for putting paint on her nails or something like that. And you can stick that out of the way, and there you go. So what we'll do now is get into fly tying. Fly tying should be fun. If it's not fun for you, take up tennis or golf. But if you can tie flies, and anybody can, I've taught it for 20 years now, and anybody can tie a fly. So what we'll do, we'll tie first that comes off, for the fly fisherman's point of view, is the first stage of the coronament, and it's a bloodworm. Now these bloodworms spend from the day they laid their little eggs, and that last whenever, last summer, last spring, they sink to the bottom, a little tiny egg, a little tiny brown egg. This gets wriggled down into the marl at the bottom, that's the mud at the bottom. It then develops in 11 days to a tiny little bloodworm, or just a hair-like bloodworm, which grows and grows, and can grow to half an inch and about a 1/16 in diameter. Now, so this is the first one we're going to tie. There have been several of these on the market. We'll tie the first conventional one for the Kamloops area. Then we'll tie one with Swan and Days that I did a lot to push forward. Now the first thing you need is a black thread. So let's just get rid of that thread out of there. I use green thread for shrimp and stuff like that, so we can lap over that, it doesn't matter. Just go over it. Now what I'm going to tie in at the end of it, point, that point is very valuable, is a tuft of black bear. As I said, use the base of your scissors when you're cutting black bear or any other bear. Now you just put it together like this, and inside it there's a down. You don't need this fine stuff. If you do dubbed-bodied flies, get a margarine container full of this stuff or whatever you're going to put it in, a plastic bag or whatever, and you can save that for dubbing later. Now, this tuft of tail, get that out of your way, Mo. You just chop it off like so, until it's straight. Now what you've got to do, you've got to tie some on top and some underneath. Not all on top, else the fly will finish up with a big rump. So stick it underneath and on top at the same time and then tie it in. That's as easy as falling out of bed. Now you don't need it that long, because flies, as a rule of thumb, don't go no further back with tails or anything than the point of the hook comes forward. And then just chop that off to there like that. And that's just about the right length for a... Let's just chop that little bit off there too. Come off. There you go. Now, chenille. Chenille is a... It's a wool wrapped around a couple of threads. So what we're going to do, we're going to get inside there and pull off. Just tease it off, and inside there, there's two threads. Or three. Now, what it's just for matter of argument's sake, if you tied it in without doing that, you'd finish up with a lump and then a thin part, and you don't need that. So, wind your thread in, tie the tin with them two little pieces there like that, and come back to where the tail is, and come forward quickly to within 1/8 of the eye, because all insects have heads. Now, beginning fly tiers will want to take this to there, and then they put the body on there, they put the wings on there, or whatever they're putting on, then they've got no room to finish. Now, wrap this away from you like this. Always away, side by side. And this makes a perfect bloodworm body. It really does. Side by side until you get to your thread. Now, take it in your right hand. Your left hand, just drop it over the top like that, and that will lock it for you. That wasn't difficult, was it? There you go, and then get your pointed scissors and chop it off. Now, there's a little bit there that I don't like yet, so it's not there now. You're the master with the scissors, so do use them. Something you don't like, chop it off. Now, wrap it a couple of times. Now, what I'm going to do, a bloodworm does not have any appendages or legs or anything like that for swimming, so we do tie in the camelot's area one just like this without any legs underneath, but I find if you put some legs from a rump feather, pheasant rump. Now, this is the short one they can barely use for anything else. So what I use it for is legs on mayflies, damselflies, stoneflies, and every other fly, because they're strong, they really are. So I'm going to break just a few off, not many. Turn it round so you've got the bend, the natural bend of the feather sticking upwards. Just tuck it underneath its chin like that, grab it with your left hand, and tie it in. As I said, they don't have these things, but when... Come here, scissors. When you are fishing this, and this little hair's underneath when you're slowly retrieving it, and I mean slow. There isn't an insect in the camelot's area that can swim like an Evinrude. They swim slowly, deliberately, they move exactly what they've got to do. So when you're retrieving it, you're retrieving it 1/4 inch at a time, usually on a full floater. In shallow water, if you go to deep water, of course, you put a sinking line on, but you still move it very, very slowly. They don't build up enough oxygen to do anything else. Now there's only one more thing to do on this little critter, is to get a peacock hill. Now a peacock hill has got a nice hairy end on it like that, that's dried out, so chop it off. It'll break on you constantly. Now just tie it in with that tip. Adjust this up so you don't belt yourself under the chin. Mo, there you go. Now pull them back and come forward with your thread. Now put this over to the top of those, we won't call them legs, we'll call them swimmer. Put them over the top like that and build up quite a nice head. It's nice and green, fluffy, and it does a beautiful job for a bloodworm. Now just put it in your right hand again, drop your thread over it, and that's all there is to it. And there you have a bloodworm. And if the legs come round, twist them. Now, put a half hitch on there if you want. That's one way of doing it. Another good way of doing it. Now there are tools for this. Now this tool was invented by somebody who doesn't like people. It's called a whip finisher. One looks like a 1952 prefix starting handle, and it's the, I can't understand how it, anyway, this is something that we came up with. It's two fingers towards you, round, drop it on top, stick this out of the way, cradle your fingers like that. Now one goes over and one goes underneath. Over and round. Four times. Over and round. Now you just pull it through and follow it closely like that. And there you have, folks, a bloodworm. A beautiful bloodworm. This is the first stage of the coronament. And when the coronament starts to hatch, like they do in my tanks at home, I have them in insects in the tank so I can take pictures of them and teach better fly tying. They change, once they start to change from the bloodworm into the pupa, which we're going to tie in a few minutes, it takes 11 days. And then when the pupa's ready, when the sun comes back to Kamloops and starts to warm that little bit of water, they'll go on a vertical migration of fish feed on them voraciously. That's why we like to fish a full floating line, a 24 leader or 22 or 26, a good long leader. Anybody can cast it with training. So what we do, we cast this, and we'll chop that little lump off. There we go, that's better, Mo. We fish it slowly. I can't emphasize that enough. You've got to fish slower than slow. If you think you're fishing slow now, slow down some more. And if you're coronament and bloodworm fishing, mayfly or anything in shallow water, you'll catch fish more. But a little dab will do you on the head, and that's all they've got to do it. Get your bodkin, clean out the eye like that, and there you have the first. This is an old Kamloops pattern. Stick it in this little piece of sponge and then we can see how we progress. There you go. One bloodworm. The next one is tied with a material called Swanandese. Come here, Hook. Swanandese is a plastic, a very translucent plastic. And I'll show you some. And this is it. It's a beautiful product for bloodworm. If that wanted to show a bloodworm, that's a perfect colour for a bloodworm. It is bright scarlet red. There is some green ones and there's some brown ones, but I've never had much luck tying them. So first of all, I better put some thread on here. Put some thread on the hook like we did before. The hook is already sitting in there nice and straight. Just wrap it on top of itself like that and get it up to the end. Cover as much of the hook as possible, because these are insects, they're not attractors. Snip him off. I've got to have a word with them. This is, they're not behaving. Okay, like the other bloodworm, we're going to put in a little tuft of black bear. Chop off the end so you get it nice and straight. Now, it's critical on this one particularly, they get as much underneath the bend, because the bend is way out of the vise, and as much on the top as you can possibly do it. Split it. Just push it on like that and tie it in like so. Round the bend more. Good. Now, get your scissors again. I don't cut it straight neither. When I cut, I just cut like that and roll. And it rolls it round the bend a little bit. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to wrap the hook a little bit to build up that. Hello! Wrap it on there like so. I did it, get right down to the bend there. Okay? Now, with this Swanandese, you'll find that there's a round side to it and a flat side. And what you're going to have to do, you're going to have to get your scissors, lay it right on top of the flat side and cut a point off like that. So you've got a pointy end right there. Because what you don't want to you get away from, there's going to be a little one, but get away from making a lump at this end. So you tie it on the side like that with the round part coming up. Now I'm going to build the hook up just a little bit there. And get to there. Now, the round part on top and the flat part underneath. And you go round, leaving a little tiny gap in between the segments. They do have seven. So that's 3, 4, 5, 6, I can even count. 7. And then bring this round in your right hand, get your thread, drop it over the top like that, and it will hold it for you. Simple. Get your pointed scissors out again and chop them. Now, just for safeguard that it won't come undone on you, just give it some wrap because you've got lots of room there. Drop a half hitch on if you want to by just simply wrapping it around your pinky. Zap it. There you go. Now adjust that back up to there. Now, like on the other blood worm we just did, I'm going to put a few fronds for legs, for swimmers. Not legs, Moses, swimmers. So fidget it around like that, get out of the way. And that's what you've got for swimmers, look. Just a few. Just stick them underneath its chin. Get underneath there. Hold it with your left hand and thumb and finger. And wrap it in. And there they've got just a few. What it does when you're pulling it towards you, they just flick a little bit. And it looks just a little bit better than Mother Nature's version of it. Now, for a head on it, same thing again. Just chop off the pointy end of this, because it's all dried. That is at the end, then it'll want to break on you. Just tie it in. Come to the end. You've left yourself lots of room, always at least 1/8 of an inch from the eye. And tie it there, progressively going forward. Now, as I was saying before, when you're fishing this little morsel, and this is fish food now, it's not an attractor. It's a fish, it's an insect that lives in the water that fish look for. They can identify with it as food, and they will take it readily. Okay, two fingers towards you, round, drop it on top, cradle your fingers like that. One over and one under. One over and one under. Push your bottom, your middle finger with your thumb like that if you want to. Four or five times, do as many times as you want. Just multiple half hitches and then pull it through. Then get your pointy scissors, zap it. Then everything's lined up nicely and put a spot of cement on it. Now that to me looks more like a bloodworm than the chenille one does, which is a really successful fly in the Kamloops district. We'll then, after this one, we're going to tie the next stage, which is coronament. Now the coronament, let's get back a little bit. Bloodworm is the first stage, that's the larvae of it. This lives in the marl at the bottom till the sun comes back, warms the water. The bloodworm says, hey, it's time to change. And in 11 days, it changes from this into the pupa. And we'll show the slide on that. And what I'm going to tie now, as I said, is a black coronament. Now, black coronament, people make them too fat without legs and tails. They do have legs, they do have a tail, and they are a very, very effective way of luring a trout with a full floating line. You can go on a sink tip. There's lines coming out your ears nowadays. There's sink tip, intermediates, barometrics. But I like to fish it again on a full floater. I cast a long line with about a 20-foot, 26-foot leader going down to 6X, down to even, sometimes I go down to 6, but I like to go down to, we measure it in diameter, 9 thou diameter or 6-pound tippet, because in the Kamloops district, any given time, you can be into fish up to 2 pounds, and then comes along granddad, and then you've got a scrap on your hands with a 4-pound tippet. So we like something about 6-pound tippet, a long piece about 6 foot, and tied on the end of your line, on the end of your leader, and then this is what you present. So what we're going to do now, for tails on these things, and what I like to do too, what I use for a tail, I like to use for legs, in most cases. And this is a guinea fowl. You can either have big spots like this or little spots. Looks like it took it off a Dalmatian dog. Now, turn it round, position them so you get just a few fronds. You don't want much. Just stick it in there. Remember, don't go no further back than the point of the hook comes forward. You'll see some flies in stores. I've seen them. I could throw up every time I see one. The hook is 3/4 of an inch long and 8. The feathers come back this far, and every fish that takes it swims away with a complex of eating feathers. And that's not what you're there for. You're there to catch a fish. Now, if you want to pinch the barb down, which we are doing now in the Kamloops area, that barb on there was put on to hold a bait on. You are tying the bait on the hook now, so you don't need a barb. So just put that there like that, hold it with your left hand, and tie it in. And it leaves just a few tiny, graceful little hairs back there, and that's all they do have. Now, chop them off, and if you get the garbage can, you're good. Now, the next thing we're going to want is a body for this. Now, there's bodies for these things coming out of Euros. You can put Fentex bodies. But there's one that I really do like is this peacock hill. I get two strands. I put them together and I strip a lot of that. You can buy them sometimes with no hairs on them. Chop it off. Now what you want to do, you're going to tie it in right where the tail is there, like so. That's your material clip. Now you can use green Fentex on this, you can use black Fentex, you can use dubbed black or dubbed whatever colour you want, but this gives it a sheen all on its own with the little tiny green hairs on. What I'm going to do now, I'm going to put some ribbing on this too. The ribbing will bury itself and be barely noticeable, but it is there. Okay? And this is fine wire. So, tie that in. You can either tie it in before, there's a little hook on there, I don't want. You can either tie it in before you put that on or after, it doesn't matter. Tie it in. And stick that in your material clip. Now get in your material clip. Stay out, see if I care. Take that back up to within 1/8 of the eye and let it dangle. It's not in your way. Now get your body material. You get in that material. I am having it only on television. And wind this round tight, really, really tight. Push it on top of each other. Now there's dozens of material you can tie these out of. Black silk, black floss, black darning silks. So you can do anything you want, but this one in particular I really do like. Now keep wrapping it till you come up to the head. There, like that. Hold it in your right hand again. Drop your thread over it like that and it'll hold it for you. There are combinations, like I just said, of tying these in any number of materials. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to chop off some of that hair. I don't want it all. And this is where a good pair of scissors will pay you. Now, there you go. Now, to stop it burying itself in there, I usually wrap away from me. Well, this time I'm going to come towards me, look like this. And it will bury itself, but you can see it. Like so. Come up to the thorax, hold it there like that, push that out of the way again, Mo. Drop that over it. That's all there is to it. Now this will make the peacock hill stand up again. So I'm going to make sure I'm tying that in good. Now I'm going to chop some more of that peacock off. Gorgeous little creature. See, when a fish sees this, it's not looking at something gaudy, big, fluorescent, and these horrible colours that people do tie. It's looking at something that it can identify as a food source. Now the same material for legs as you put on for a tail. The same feather. Don't change your feather. Just tease it around till they're all the same length. Now there we've got some beautiful little legs. Don't, whatever you do, put them in down to underneath your vise and chop them off to length. You want this fine hair right there. Stick it underneath its chin and tie it in. Gorgeous. Now, for a thorax, every insect does have a thorax. Same peacock hill again, chop it off. If it's not too fat, this peacock, you can buy it, there's some fat and some thin, get another chunk and put it aside of it. So now you can build a head up a thorax really quickly and tie that in there like so. And wrap this right on top of where you tied the legs in, like that. Beautiful stuff. I did it. One will do. One will do in this case too. Just wrap it on there like that and build a little thorax. Drop that over. Now coronament, when they come out of the marl at the bottom, they've changed from the bloodworm into this little creature and it's heading for the surface. It will head up there. It usually tries to pick, they will move from deep water to shallow water. And they'll pick in an area 15 foot so they don't have to swim too far, because they're very poor swimmers. They kick the bodies, which we'll show in the slide presentation, to get to the surface. Then they hit that surface tension, and the surface tension is, to them, is a brick wall. And they lay underneath there. I've seen them lay as long as 10 or 15 minutes. And that's where you as a fly fisherman and me, you get your long leader, you belt it out there, a good cast, straighten your line, lower your rod tip, and start retrieving it 1/4 of an inch at a time. A natural drift. If you can use the wind, use it. But keep your line straight, keep mending your line. Because the fish will touch it, pull it a quarter of an inch, and then you've got to hit it. So, we'll keep talking about coronament. Now this gorgeous ostrich plume, I'm going to get one little hair off it. Now remember, it's dried out there too, so chop it off. This represents the forward gills on a coronament, which we will see quite clearly on the slides. Now just wrap that round. You've got lots of room to finish. Don't crowd the eye. Now wrap this on top of itself like this. Push it back like that. Let it stick up proudly. There you got it. Now fished right, and I'm going to keep talking about retrieving slowly. You've got a killing machine right there. In fact, we call one the green machine, tied in a green wool. You see, you've got lots of room to finish. You have not crowded the eye. If you crowd the eye, you're going to fight it forever and a day. It'll keep dropping off the end now. Two fingers towards you, round, drop it on top, and over, over and under. Isn't that simple? If you can dance, you can do this. And pull it through. Now your point of scissors, that's where the point comes in every time. Zap. Now, pull them back and get your head cement. I like to wipe a lot of it off because it comes out from the bottom of that bottle full loaded. Now just do that. Hold it back so it doesn't wet it down. And touch it. And there you have a coronament that will catch a fish in any of our 1,200 lakes in the Kamloops area. And there is 1,200. Most of them are natural stock. Some of them are introduced stock. 33 of them. Clean the eye out like this so it's nice and clean so you don't have to do it on the lake. You might have to do it because it might roll back in there. So in your fly box, and when you are tying these, you've tied one. So tie a half a dozen of each fly at each size. Like my fly box has got 1,500 in it. One coronament I start with, 12 2X, and I go down to 14 2X, no smaller. You can go down to 22s, then you've got to go down leader size. And the Kamloops area's got a multitude of fish between the 4 and 8 pound region. And you get that on a big fish, on a small leader, you're entertaining them, and I'm there to catch them. Okay? So there's the coronament, we'll stick it to the side of its little brother here. And that's the first stage of it, and the second stage. And what we can tie now is something that is a complete oddity. And it is an oddball, this little character. It's called a Swanandy's glass worm. And I tied this for myself first. And I went to try one of our mini lakes called Peter Hope. And it was an instant knockout. Now, for tail, you can use the same thing again. You can use anything for a tail on this, but it's got to be short, and the legs, as I said before, have got to be short to match. They're not legs, they're swimmers. And I can't use that because it's come undone. So we use black thread. What I do like to do too sometimes, I will change the base of the thread on here. Like on the bloodworm, for instance, that really purple, maroon, deep look. If you want to change it, put white thread on your hook, and it will bring it redder and pinkier. So we'll do the same again. Now this Chiavrus larva is an absolute knockout, and they call it the glass worm. Chiavrus takes a lot of saying, it takes more spelling too. So what we're going to do, we've got here some clear Swanandy's, and it is clear look. This glass worm, they told us in all the books I've read, which is very little, that it first comes off in spring, and then when the its food source will go away, which is daphnia and stuff like this. It hatches off into a little green smut coronament, flies away, and then that's the end of the cycle. Well, that's not quite true because I've caught fish on it and caught and found them in the water as late as mid-July. So break off the little bit you want before. Put your scissors down. No, good idea. Now what I'm going to do, where the end of that white, I'm going to tie it in quite long because I'm going to chop it off. The gill on this thing is like a little fan, and it's right there, and it's a short little thing, like that. Okay, now you can get rid of this, you don't need it, and then drop it in the garbage can, if you can find it. Now that swan and ease is really good. It's actually disappeared, here we go. It's transparent. So what I'm going to do, like on the other one, I'm going to lay it flat on my finger like that. And you've got to be patient with it. You've got to cut a point on the end. Good shot, Moses. Now remember, there's a flat side and a round side. So what I'm going to do, as you'll see in the slide, it has two little flotation tanks equally spaced there and there, and that's its holding lungs. So you stick that underneath its back end there like that and tie it in. And get this out of the way. One, two, three. Now bring your bobbin back and tie that off. That's the back segments before the flotation tank. You just chop it off like so. Now I'm going to tie that down really good. There you go. There's a chunk sticking up there that's going to come off. Now, back to the ostrich plume. This represents the flotation tanks that keep this thing horizontal. Why? I know the flotation. I'd got some of these in a tank one time at home, and along came a greedy shrimp, grabbed hold of it and fought with it and burst one of the back ones, and it still got away. And it was totally unoriented. It just couldn't swim straight. It was swimming in spirals after that. So these are the flotation tanks that keeps it buoyant and straight. So chop off the pointy end and tie that right at the end of there. Now when it comes around to July and August, when there's algae in the water, they turn to black like this one. Okay? But in springtime, right now, as soon as the ice goes off, this is exactly what it'll look like. So tie that in there on top of itself, because you're going to chop some off in a minute. There you go. Now bring your thread back and come right next to it like that. Get your scissors and chop it off. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to give it a haircut. So I don't particularly want it that big and fluffy. You can't blow any time flies like that on a table, so you've got to pick all your feathers up. Now, it's swan and ease again. This is the biggest pain with swan and ease, is to cut that point on the end, and if you don't, you'll finish up with a lump. And I'm sure, I'm no fish cut on that particular, but I am. So, lay it on top of your finger, and right on top of the blade of your scissors. And it's actually behaving itself today. There you go. Tie it with the flat side down, like so in a second, underneath Moses, not on top, and come up to there. Now, finish the segments off. One, two, three, four, five, and tie it off again. Now I put another flotation tank in there, a few swimmers for legs, which they don't have in the real insect, but they do, it does make it look alive in water. So, with my flotation tank gone, this is my flotation tank. I'm going to stick it in there, right on top of that last segment. You can barely see any of the body. And that's where I said hackle pliers work, Mo, and they work better than your fingers. There you go. Just wrap it on top. Come slowly forward. Now this is a fly that not many people have heard of, never mind used, but they do work. And those times when you go to a lake and the fish are moving everywhere and they're feeding, I don't mean jumping out of the water like 4 foot like they do at Tunqua and splash back into the lake. They're not feeders. They're just having a good time. I'm talking about when fish come underneath the surface and porpoise, and you can see they're definitely feeding, but you don't see anything on the water, because if you're looking from above on this one, you will not see it in water. It's totally transparent. The only thing you can see, and I'll show you on the slide, is the eye, the diet track, and the tail, and the gill, not the tail. What do we call it, a tail on this? Okay, now come forward, and with the same material, I'm going to put a few legs under, just a few fine hairs. You can use anything for this. You can use groundhog, squirrel tail, as long as you use that little piece, the tiny, tiny hairs. Not thick. If they're too long, you don't chop them off. Isn't that a gorgeous little morsel? Now, with your fingers around on top and put a head on there. Now, what I have done in the past, and when I've used black thread for this, I've got some pretty nail varnish, pink, white, whatever colour you want it, and just whiten the head out so you don't see that black. But they do have the tiniest little black eye. So that's why I don't on some dress them, and some I do. And this one I'm not going to. I'm going to build a black head up like that. Now remember, when you're fishing this, you've got to remember it's more than important. If you don't fish it right, you might as well chuck dynamite in there and swim. But you've got to cast it out there, straighten your line, full floating line with a long leader, and fish it very, very slowly, which we'll show you on presentation. We're going to present this thing. Clean the eye out, and that's the end of the coronament species, the coronament family. Now, when you're tying coronaments, of course we tied a black one, you can tie all sorts of materials for the body. Then you can tie, as long as they're tight and shiny, put the segments in with the ribs, you've got black, green and brown. And there's a moose hair coronament, but not many people in the world can get moose hair, so we'll leave that one out for now. It's not that important, as long as you tie the basic. Tie them skinny, there is no fat ones. You tie them in proportion, and if you can, bend that barb off your hook. Some people take a lot of convincing to do that. But if you can catch a fish and you can release it unarmed. You just had a bad day that day. The next one I want to tie, a John Dexheimer sedge. It's a tightly tied little thing, and for a back on it, it's got a feather that is shaped perfectly for this insect. And John, I'm sure, it was a good fisherman in the Tonquil Leighton 6 mile range, which is west of Kamloops. So I want to use green thread too, so start off as you did before. No problem, 10 wraps, that's enough. I've never did count the damn things really. Now, some people are going to wonder whether we should put lacquer on. I'll put lacquer on this one. I do on some I don't, care, because I've got wax thread anyway. So. Put the top on each time, because if you cock it over, it makes a hell of a mess. Now, first of all, you're going to put in, there's no tail on a sedge. None at all. So you're going to put a piece of peacock hair in to make sure it's strong. I chop off about an inch. I'll give it a couple of pulls. There we go, that's good and strong. Tie that in, like so. Let it dangle, stick in your material clip. The body material is green fentex, olive green fentex. Now remember, there is no fat flies, so I'm going to strip this fentex down until there's just a few fibres. This can be tied with a dubbed green body, but whatever it is, it has to be an olive green in colour. I always chop off that pointy end there, I don't like it. This is green thread, by the way, I'm tying it with, so just tie it in the middle. When you're tying any wool bodies, tie them in the middle, because that's the fattest part. Cigar-shaped body. So just wrap it on and on and on and on to the rear end, then get up to within 1/8 of the eye. Get in there. Now, thin. That's the best about fentex. You can split it and flatten it. It makes a beautiful, tight, cigar-shaped body like an insect would be. This is a good fly. Fished on any line you like. Sink tip, nymph tip, intermediate, floating. I've caught fish on every one of them. One of the biggest fish I caught on one of these was 11 pounds on a tiny hook like this too, in Peter Hopeless, or Peter Hope. Now, remember, you're wrapped away from you when you put the body material on, so wrap to, don't cut it, towards you like this. Just put in a hairy segment on like that. Isn't that beautiful? Keep them spaced out the same. And lock it. You tie something over there to make sure nothing's going to go bad. Now, what we've got to do, we've got to get this feather to caress the back just perfectly. Now, as I said, the mallard grew this for us. It's off the drake mallard breast. The breast of the mallard goes right round its head, in fact. Now, you just put it on top of your finger like so, and your thumb, and chip off all the down that keeps the duck warm. You don't need that. And it can float and settle in your whatever you're drinking or whatever. Now, that's what you're going to finish up with. A wedge-shaped fly, feather. Now, lay that on the top like so. Pinch it with your left finger and thumb like that and hold it tight. Three firm wraps, three. Now, don't just pull it through. Get hold of your, with a finger and thumb, and use your second finger as a roller and roll it like so. And it will caress the back. One more little pull, Moses. Like that. Now, isn't that gorgeous? This feather, I'm sure, was grown by Mother Nature just for this fly. Now, I'm going to tie it off. And all you're going to do now is put a forward hackle on it. Now, I always like to put a little half hitch on there before the feather wants to split on me, which it sometimes may do. There you go. Now, get together, that's it. Now you can either put a full beard hackle or a forward hackle, and I like both. Now remember, we went through hackles. This is a good hackle feather. It's thin, it's fairly long for the size of it, and it will make a perfect hackle, forward or beard. So, chop off the chicken down underneath. When you go to tie it in, tie it with the bend towards the hook and the shiny side. This side of the feather will go away. The outside, this polished side, towards you. Now, stick it on the side like that, where the body ends, and tie it in. Now, before you do anything, get rid of that piece sticking out. Zap it. Now, hackle pliers, you can't do it without. Get your hackle pliers and pinch it sideways, like that, so you've got the feather in sideways. Now wrap it round with the dull side pointing still backwards, like that. Now this little sedge will hatch off any time from, what can we say, from the end of May, June, July, August, and into September. So you've got a beautiful round, all-round fly. Now bring it to the front, hold it in your right hand and drop your left hand over it like that. And zap it. Now, to stop tying anything down, I'm going to leave this as a forward hackle. Bring them all back and put a shoulder right up to them. And you've still got lots of room to put a head and to, ouch, there's a hook there, Moses. Two fingers towards you. Over and over and over. Four times is enough. Come on, settle down. And zap it. There's one hair there that shouldn't be. So, we'll take it off. Now, before I lacquer this thing, this could be a dry fly with the hackle point like that. You don't want it to be. Take it out. Put it between your finger and thumb and squeeze it. Roll it. You won't hurt that back feather. You won't hurt nothing. But what you're doing, you're breaking that little frond to make it lay back, to make a nymph out of it. Like so. Now isn't that a gorgeous little... There's still that one there. Ah, good. I'm going to put your lacquer on. Just a dabble, do you? And there you have a John Dexheimer sedge. And I said, John lived in Savannah. I wrote an article on this character too. He's quite a recluse. He used to keep himself to himself. And if anybody ever gave, if he gave you a fly and you gave it away or showed it to anybody else, he wouldn't speak to you. So he wouldn't speak much to me. And there you got it. Isn't that a gorgeous little creature? The next one I want to tie is a fly that's terribly misunderstood. It's called a mayfly. In fact, its original name in Isaac Walton's Complete Angler was the dayfly. It lives 24 hours as a terrestrial. It lives up to a year as a nymph. So that's what we're going to tie. We're going to tie the nymph of the mayfly, or the 24-hour fly, or the day fly, or whatever you want to call it. And it is a pretty little thing, and it's very, very predominant in the fish food's life, because it comes from the egg form, of course, into a little nymph. It's an incomplete metamorphosis. No blood, there's no worm stage to this. It's from egg to nymph to terrestrial. So what we're going to do, we'll tie this little nymph. It's tied again on a 12. You can tie it on any size you want under the 12 line. Go down to 22s if you want. Then, of course, you'll be into trouble with the side of your leader. So I'm going to use green thread again. Just wrap it on, like so. Now, this is mainly tied with the pheasant tail. And the pheasant tail being this creature. I've chucked some off there already. I've chucked that off there too. And what I'm going to look for, here we go, is one that's got a long frond on it, because you're going to want it for the body and the tail at the same time. Now, select just barely enough, because it only has three tails. That's all it does have. Now pinch it in there. You're going to make it just a little bit longer, because you're going to bend it later. So, tie it in like so. Get back to the bend. I'm going to tie down on top of that. So I want the body to start with the tail end. Then come up, because you're only going halfway down with the body material anyway. And why we like this fly, this feather for this, the gills on the mayfly are external. And they stand up like little tiny hairs on its back. So, over you go. Now we're going to put a wing case in there, a thorax, and then legs. And then we've got a mayfly. Isn't that simple? Now this will hatch off too in late September. I was at one of our local lakes many years ago in early September, and I got to the lake and the swallows were feeding on something, and I went down and looked and they were feeding on a mayfly hatch, and it was a big one. And I caught all sorts of fish on this morsel. Now the same material for wings. Break a generous amount off, turn it over. Now on this feather you can see there's a tiny little black bar. Now I want that black bar to finish in the middle of its wing case. So I'm going to chop off that chunk, come back one wrap, about 1/8 of an inch, and tie it in. There, we got it. Now, for a thorax on this, I want to want a little bit more, so I'm going to pinch out of here 2 or 3 fairly fat ones. There's 2 and 1 here already, that's 3. So I'm going to build up quite a thorax on it. Like that. In. Now notice I've gone halfway down with the wing. If you put the wing, say an 1/8 of an inch there, by the time you bend it over, you don't have one. So, just wrap this on there like that. This is the thorax. Now you fish this like you would any other. Coronament or Chiavrus larva, a bloodworm, you can fish it on a full floater. I like to find 15 foot of water over a weedy area because they like weed for cover. Now, before you put the wing over, you put the legs on. And I still use the same feather. Now, the legs on a mayfly, are stronger because it has to cling to things all its life. They're not delicate by any means. So, just get this point like that, the point of the pheasant, stick it underneath its chin. Okay, there's another thing. Don't just tie it straight like that. Stick it right through, bring your left finger and thumb round, and tie it in, like that. Now that's obviously too long. So, pull it through a little bit. Perfect. What a delicate little morsel. That's best about fly tying. You can create what you see. It's like an artist, he picks a piece of paper and a pencil and he puts what his eye sees on paper. That's all we're doing here. Just bend the wing case over and that black bar is right in the middle. Anyone think I'd done this before? And then you tie that down there like that. Chop him off. That's where you want your pointed scissors for all the time. Now, 2 fingers towards you, round. Drop it on top. This out of the way. One over and one under, over and under. Isn't that nice? Now the wing case can be used, you can use anything. Plastic bags, raffia, owl wing if you're lucky enough to get one. Now before you do anything else, what I do, I take it out of the vise and I'm going to twist the tail to come upwards like that, just on your thumbnail. Like that. That's why I put more than one more time. That's why I tied more than three in. If you tie more than, you just tie three in and you pull one off, then you only have two. Then I'm going to chop that off and I want to leave three. And if I've got the shakes, I'll leave more. Come off. One more to go. Fish can't count, but I can, so. And there you have a gorgeous tiny little mayfly. Fish it slowly again, no fast insects. Fish it slow, look for a 15-foot area. I like to fish this on a lake I call Stump Lake. And the outside perimeter of it tapers off from 2 foot to 15 for a hell of a long way. And I cast it towards the weeds, the bulrushes, and pull it in little pulls on a full floating line, and I've had tremendous success on this little fly. So we will stick it in the vise, in the plastic in a minute. There we go. Tweeze it. Stick it in this sponge, I called it plastic a minute ago. There you go. And there we've got another one. Okay, the next one is a step up from this to the damsel fly. The halfback is a damsel fly pattern. We're going to tie it to 967210. And we use black thread. We just wrap it on like we did before. And right to the bend. Now for a tail on this, you can use almost anything again. So I'm going to go back to my trusty pheasant tail. Quite a generous amount. Let's stick it together. What you've got to represent is this tiny little tuft of a tail. You'll see better in the Swanandays one, which we tie after. Tie it in and wrap it round. Gorgeous tail, not too long, not too short. And zap it. Now, for a body material again, we get to this peacock hail. It's absolutely gorgeous, very versatile for 99% of the flies we tie in camels, I think. Snip off the tip and come forward to there. It's almost an enlarged mayfly nymph. And wrap it on. Keep going, right to the end, side by side. Side by side, here we go. Now just tie that, don't chop that off yet, okay? Now I'm going to go back, because I'm going to tie a wing case in to halfway. Now for a wing case on this, you can use anything again, and I'm going to get back to my trusty pheasant tail and pinch it. Chop off the point and you don't need it. Now tie it in upside down, so the good side is down. Like so, twist it back, Moses, good. The reason I didn't chop that off, because I'm tying all that thorax down, so I'm going to get to the front and tie it in. There we go, they've got quite a large thorax, which is good. And tie that over, easy. Now, try and hit the garbage can. What you can do, now you can either put a beard hackle underneath there, or a forward hackle. What I'm going to do is a beard hackle, and at the side of me I've got this beautiful cape still, this one. Absolute gorgeous thing. Bend it and you'll see them lined up ready to be pulled out of there, like that. And that is a perfect hackle feather. Hackle feathers have got to, keep reminding you, pardon me, it's got to be long, the fronds have got to be fine so you don't have to cut them off later. Get rid of the chicken down and tie them in with a point, like that. Easy. Chop it off. Keep it clean up front at all times. Now somewhere underneath the lot, they've got some hackle pliers. Where you gone? There you gone. They're always hiding, these little characters. Now, pinch it in the tip like that, like you did before, and wrap it round. This is going to be a beard hackle. The legs just hang underneath its chin. So wrap it at the end of the thorax, side by side. Come forward with your right hand and then you drop it over with your left. Like that. Now, to collect all those hackles together, they come round and round and up. Now float your finger and thumb down a couple of times to grab them all, like that. And tie it down. There we go. Chop off any that don't want to do it. Good. Now those will disappear because I'm going to tie the wing case down now over the back of it. It's exactly what we just tied, but bigger. And this is called a halfback though, and this that other one's called a mayfly. Now, the wing case, as I said, you can use anything. On some of mine, I get stripped goose quill, the finer, not the thick stuff, and put that on, it's a wing feather, and then put the white wing on. On some, I put teal, and some, I put black raffia. And you can have half a dozen of each in your arsenal. Now, two fingers towards you again, over and round. Fish this on any line. I've fished 99% of my fishing on a full floater, and I put myself in an area where I know these insects are going to be, and I can fish a full floater without any trouble. You don't want to fish a full floater, for instance, in 60 foot of water, so you put yourself in a position where you've got 15 or so, and put a dab on the head, and that'll do the trick. And clean the eye. And there's the halfback. Now, halfback, damselfly, big mayfly, brown coronament, it can be a lot of things if you tied it down smaller. Okay, I'm going to stick this in beside of that little tiny mayfly. The next one is a real special one of mine. It's tied on the same size hook, 9-6-7-2-10. But I tie it with swanandaise, and it shows the segments up really, really. But what we're going to tie in first is a tail, a three tail. Now, when a damselfly goes to feed, goes to breathe, it passes its tail through the water several times and picks up oxygen and loads it into its body. And this is stripped goose quill. And I'll show you what it looks like. That's what it looks like. And each one of these makes a perfect gill. There's going to be three, one, two, three, on the side of this little gem for catching fish, and it really, really does work in a weeded bulrushy type area, because when these come to hatch off, they wriggle till they get to the bulrushes, climb up the bulrushes facing the sun, split the case, and the terrestrial flies away, copulates, lays eggs, and away we go again. The male is usually bright blue and the female is a drab green or browny color. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to chop off three of these. One, they fly all over the table if you're not careful. Two, three. Now, you pick them up by wetting your finger. Now I'm going to put the one with the natural bend away from you on that side. There you go. One in the middle. Right over the middle. Keep your wrap down to a limit, because you're going to have to put swanandaise on the back end of this one. Now the bend is towards me again. Stick it on there. Good. Now you've got three forks for three gills. In fact, what I'm going to do, I'm going to come back a little bit further around the bend. Good. Perfecto. Swanandaise trick. Now remember, there's a flat side. This is quite a lot bigger than the last one we did for the bloodworm. So lay it, oh come on, lay it on there. And chop it. A little bit more. There you go, more. Good. And I've just thinned it down a little bit so I don't have to finish with a big lump there. And go back. Now remember the flat side, because it wants to turn on you, this stuff does all the time. Keep the flat side to the hook. There you go. Now, wrap it. That's going to make that squeaky noise, you'll have to put up with that. Now you see the segments it's building up. I'll show it on slide, a view of one of these with all the segments intact, and you can even see through this stuff. That's absolutely gorgeous. Looks like a series of beads dyed on there. Now wrap it both sides to V it in like that, cross it. That's the thread, that is. Chop it off short. I'm going to wrap that end down because I don't want it sticking up like that. Now come back down three segments of the body. Now back to the pheasant tail. Now I'm going to tie the wing in like I did the half back and the mayfly. So chop off that pointy end and tie it in. There you go. That's still sticking up, so I'm going to chip it off. Peacock hell again. Makes a hell of a messy table, this thing, this stuff. Now, there we go. I'm going to tie quite a big thorax in there, not that big. Chop off the pointy end. And tie the thorax in. That makes a perfect thorax. Nice and green and follows you all around the house. There you go. Chop it off. Now, on this one, I'm going to put another beard hackle with the same type of a feather. There are beautiful short hackles on it, short fronds on it for a hackle feather. Chop off the chicken down and tie it in at the side there like that. Always the bend away from you, the good side towards you. Tie it in. Tie it in pretty well because you want to pull on it. Chop off that little tiny piece. Hackle pliers. Beard hackle, remember. You could put a forward hackle on this, but I want a beard hackle to represent the legs under its chin. So you've got lots of room to finish there. Wrap it in tight. There you go. All the feather you can use. I'll come up forward and over. Now, remember we've got to get these down there now, so wind your thread through them, like so. Pull it up, about 2 inches or so. Wind your hand down, like that. And tie it in. There you go, beautiful. Now there's something going to stick around, so you've got the scissors, zap them. There you go, gotcha. Now the wing case, over. Now this damselfly, again, fish slowly, but not quite a short pull, it's a 6-inch pull, because they can wriggle quite well for 6 inches. And 4 inches and 2 inches, let it sit there. But not at 40 miles an hour, because they can't do it. Then wrap it off. You see the segments, it shines in water when the camel up sun and you have lots of sunshine. 2,000 hours on an average year, which is pretty good. And cut them off. And there you've got a gorgeous damselfly. Looks like a damselfly, and it is a damselfly. It doesn't have a silly name like a Bewick 52 or somebody special. Now, what comes after this is a fly that is very, very versatile in the Kamloops area too. And that nearly got me. Stick this aside of that. You can see the similarity. You've got a damselfly and a halfback. The next one is a fly that I really enjoy tying. It's called a fullback. Any amount of combinations of colours for the body you want. Can be anything. What I like is a peacock hill body again. I like to stick to the colours that are natural. And there's no natural pinks, reds, or any colour like that in fresh water. Not as an insect. As an attractor, you can tie any colour you want. And that's all it is an attractor. So, the fullback, and it's a gem too. You can tie it much bigger than this if you want to represent a dragonfly. But I don't like too big a hook, so it can do too much damage to the fish's mouth. So I don't go no bigger than a 10 or 8 2X. A 10 2X is just about as big as I want to go. Now pinch down the barb if you want to. You won't lose fish because of it. To prove a point, I was fishing with a gentleman one day and he didn't want to pinch his barb down. So I belted out a long line, got a fish, and I put slack line between the fish and myself, and it still didn't come off. When I netted it, it was a 4-pound rainbow, Kamloops rainbow trout. When I netted it, the hook fell away in the net. And I think I convinced the character after that. Now, pheasant tail again. I'm glad there's lots of pheasants in this one. About a quarter of an inch. You need a lot, because you're going to tie over the top of it. Now, what I like to do is to level off them parts, the end, the tail, that stubby little tail, like that, and tie it in. It's a beautiful fly, this one. Now, there's one straggler there, I don't want him. Then I'm going to put a wrap on the top of that to dee-da-da-da-da, to get it back. There. Isn't that easy? Now, quite a generous amount of this. I'm almost too generous, that's the problem. There you go. Chop off the pointy end and tie it in. And come back up to within 1/8. Always within 1/8 of it. Tie it. Get out of the way. Now, fishing this again, a dragonfly lives in a weeded area where it can lay in ambush for little things like mayflies, chironomid, shrimp. They like shrimp. They really do like a lot of shrimp. In my tanks, if I have one dragonfly and 200 shrimp, it's not long before there's one fat dragonfly and no shrimp. Now, I'm going to come back over the... It won't show. It really won't, because it buries itself inside there. It takes four wraps from there to there. Okay, now flatten this out. Bend it over. One wrap. This is green threading, by the way, olive green. Forward the same amount, and over again. Pull it tight. Over. Three. I want four. One more. There you go. Now, that's the segments of the dragonfly, a stubby little tail. Now, you've got to have a wing case. So bend this back again out of your way. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to put a beard hackle on this one again, then just bend this over. And it's as simple as that. And I've got a beautiful little hackle here waiting to do it. Chop off that little bit there. Now, the bend again away from you. The V where the body stop finishes. Tie it in pretty skookum. Whoa, hackle pliers, they're not hiding this time. Pinch it sideways. And wrap it round. Two, three, what am I counting it for? I could do this in my sleep almost. I'll keep wrapping it. Now, dragonflies live in fresh water from 1 to 5 years as a nymph. And then they emerge as that thing that looks like a helicopter and hovers over top of you and looks at you for a while. And then it lays eggs. They eat until either they are eaten or the frost comes around and nips them and that freezes them. That's the end of them because they're only a gelatin body. Now, over. Get as many as you can. Come down. I got my finger on the end of the hook here. That gives you the point. There you go. Ouch. Good. Bend the wing forward. Now, what I don't like to do on this, don't pull it too tight. Pull it tight first of all, and then when you go to tie it, pull it back a little bit like that. So I'll show you what it does. It puckers the body up, the wing, like that. Now, isn't that a gorgeous morsel? As I said, you can use anything for body material. You can dub one, which is really, really good and alive and holds water good. A maroon one is really good. I've tied a black one with a little silver fleck in it to represent oxygen bubbles through photosynthesis settling on these little creatures as they sit there. And there you have it. A fullback. So we tied the mayfly, the halfback, the damselfly, and this fullback. Now there's a morsel for you. And that's pretty important fish food. And they will eat anything that swims past the end of the nose, even little fish. The dock spratly. It's a fly that if somebody said to me that I'd got to fish a year with one fly, what would it be? And I would say a dock spratly. It's a leech, it can be a sedge pupa, it can be a coronamid if you tie it small enough, which would be cheating, or it's a dragonfly. So this is one of the most round flies, and it's a steelhead fly as well. A beautiful, beautiful fly. Now, tied originally, I teach fly tying, and when I taught people this, they had a lot of trouble with pulling down too hard here and cocking this tail feather as a segment of it, cocking it up like that, and it didn't look right. So I changed it a little bit, and I'll show you what I changed it to. And it's a fish catcher. It rides nice in water. Now this is guinea fowl, quite a generous portion of guinea fowl tail. Stick it out. Now remember, no further back than the point comes forward, like that. Tie it in. You can tie it all in because you're going to put a body on there and tinsel and all sorts of things now. Gorgeous creature. Now, if you can always remember too what you're going to use last, try to put in first. In most cases it doesn't really matter which way you do that, but this is tinsel. It's gold on one side and silver on the other, and I'm not really bothered which side comes out, but let's try and make the silver come out. So we'll tie the gold. Where is the gold? Here we go. The gold is this side. Tie it in. Tie about a quarter of an inch in. Now the body, black fentex. The reason I'd like fentex is because you can split it. You can split individual hairs on this stuff, but not in this case, that's enough. I've split it down to a third of its size already. Tie it in the middle. Come slowly back, back, back. And then slowly forward again. There you go. That's easy. My feather's gone up my nose. Fishing a dock spratly is something that doesn't take no more patience than anything else, but it's such a productive fly. It looks like an insect in water. I make a cigar-shaped body, pull your fentex tight, drop that over there like that, one on each side, and chop it off. Now, that alone, I'm sure, would catch fish without the rest of it. Now, I went away from me with the body material, so I'm going to come towards me, making seven equal gaps in between this tinsel, fine tinsel. There you go. Hold it up front and drop this over that side. Keep hold of it and drop that side and tie it in. Now there you've got a big coronament. And if coronament were that big, the fish would be even bigger than they already are. Now for the tail, for the tail I used guinea fowl, and I want to use it for the legs, but quite a generous amount. Pinch off at least half an inch and pucker it together, so you've got a bunch of legs together like that. Now stick that right through, bring your finger and thumb over it, and tie it in. Now leave yourself lots of room to finish. You always need it. If you crowd the eye, you've shut yourself down before you get there. Now isn't that the most gorgeous thing you ever saw? It's a golden pheasant, part of a golden pheasant cape. And why I like this feather, it caresses the body like on the deck salmon, which we just tied. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put on a little red one. It is a little thing, look. Only a little touch of red. Take off the chicken down. Get it off there. Now, lay it on the back, the spine right down the middle. Pinch it and tie it in. Okay? That was easy. Oh, it just broke at the right. You see the shine on that red on there, and it really does look good in water, and it caresses the body like the shell or the wing or whatever it wants to be of the insect itself. Now for top dressing on that, out of this beautiful thing, it is a gorgeous looking thing, I am going to put a gold one. That it must be this one, it fell out all on its own. Chop off the chicken down again. Now remember, fly tying is a mist. Fred can look after that later. Lay that on the back again. Just the V, where the V on that one is. So you're tying it in with the centre pith of this feather, centre stem. Three firm wraps, and roll it again like the Dexheimer. Don't let go of this yet. You'll know when you've done it. Well, isn't that... The first time I tried this, I was fishing with a good friend of mine, and I made 9 casts in a place I call the pantry, and got 9 fish over 4 pounds. So I thought, well, Moses, it works. And believe me, it does. Now, all you have to do, put a peacock hill head on there. Remember to chop off that pointy end. Get together. Now you can wrap back onto where you tied that in just a little bit to make that head quite large, green and shiny. And you've still got lots of room to finish. Ah, isn't that easy? Now this can be fished, get round there, on any line. As again, I would fish it on a full floater in shallow water, 10, 15 foot of water, from 2 foot to 15 foot. And it will produce fish if fish are feeding. If they're not feeding, nothing will catch them, only dynamite. There you got it. A Doc Spratley, Mo Bradley style. It's still called a Doc Spratley, never mind Mo Bradley. There you got it. And it really, really floats. I had a friend of mine cast down the side of my boat and it floated in perfect, in nice little hutches like that. And it looked like a fish wanted to take it there and then. Now, we'll find my bodkin. I'll just clean the eye out. When you get your box, your fly box, which should have, well, mine's got 1,500, yours should have at least 1,000 flies in it. Make it quite nice. But carry a bodkin or a pin just to clean the eye out. So you might just block it up and not know. Okay, let's start this side now. There you go. Now that's the Spratley. Now there's something lives in fresh water that we just cannot do without. And one is a shrimp, of course, which we're going to tie. And then one is a leech. A leech has got to be, it doesn't fly away, it doesn't hatch off into anything else, it just does its thing. Swims around all day and it's been eaten and it'll eat anything that sticks around long enough for it to get attached to. And it only takes a few seconds to tie this little morsel. It's black, but again, make it ring to you. Again, what I like to do is change it just a little bit to make it more appealing to the fish than just a blob of black. So what I do, get a dyed snow goose and it's dyed red. Don't try to break it off. Chop off about 1/8 of an inch, like that. Now, stick this right on top, sticking out no further back than the point comes forward. And then tie it in. There you go. And come back up here again. You can put tinsel body on this if you want to, a tinsel wrap with the body. I'd do 6 that way and 6 without. In fact, in my box, I think I have 50 different leeches. Now come to the middle and tie the fat part where you tie that in there. Come up to within 1/8 of an inch. Wrap this away from you, keeping it flat to start with. In the middle, just wrap on itself time after time till you build it up cigar-shaped type. There you go, and then taper it off to the back, to the front. Taper, taper, taper. Good. Leave yourself lots of room to finish. You know what you're going to do now? You're going to tie in some ostrich, or what we use in Canada called tom turkey. I think we've got more turkeys than we have marabou or ostrich. Fluffy, isn't it? What I'm going to do, this matted down here, I don't want it, so I'm going to get rid of that chunk and that chunk. Now that's perfect length, because I want it to blink on the back of there like that. Now pinch about a good 1/2 inch off. Pucker it together, like so. Don't bother about the length yet. Chop off that white because you don't need it. Tie the top on first. Good. Don't bother about the length yet. Now, on the other side of the same feather, it will be a little shorter, but don't worry about that, because you don't want it short underneath to clear the barb. Now turn it round, chop off the pointy end, or this blunt end is down at the pointy end, you twit, stick it underneath there like that and tie it in. And that's not difficult. That's going to flow up just like a, it's gone crazy now, look, a static electricity in the air. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to determine the length of the tail, and I'm just going to break that off there. Don't cut it off, break it off. Now comes the crowning glory to finish this fly off perfectly. On the neck of a peacock, you have a gorgeous feather that's iridescent, blue, metallic. That, now isn't that a, get off there, a beautiful creature. A lady delivered me one, Charlie, 5 years old, died, froze to death. And I've got all his feathers, bless him. Now, pinch off a generous amount, at least half the length of that feather. Don't let it get away on you. Like that. I've got a natural bend to it. Now tie that down that side. You don't have to look, but it's the right length anyway. Pucker them out, get them out of the way. Anything that doesn't behave itself, you've got the scissors. Now on the other side, use the other side of the feather. Got a natural bend curvature to it. Like so. Ain't that nice? Stick that in there. The reason I use this stuff, in my workshop at home, I have three tanks with insects in them all the time. And the sun was setting through the window, and in the west where I live in Westside in Kamloops, and this leech was swimming away, and I just happened to look, and there was iridescent flash on the side of it, and it was truly iridescent. And that's what I put on this one. And it really did well after it. It did well before, but it did better after it. Wrap it on, and there you've got another one. We could sit doing this all day, it's easy. Now what I like to do, before I lacquer it, I put it in my fingers again and I roll it like that. And it intermingles everything together, just like it, part of it. Now, stick it back in your vise. Oops, stick it in there, I can't see the vise. Now to prove a point to you, what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna, don't taste very nice, wet it like that. And it just flows out perfect, just like a leech should. And put that on there like that. And there you got it. Isn't that a gorgeous thing? Okay, the next one in the arsenal, of my fly box arsenal, is the woolly worm. Now the woolly worm usually, to me, is tied wrong. And I've actually taken the worms out of the sedge cases and looked at these things. They don't look like a woolly worm commercially tied. First of all, they have a two-coloured body. And the hairs on the back, the woolly part itself is quite short. So this is what we're going to do. On this one last fall at Tonquil Lake, I had numerous big fish, endless, all until the first blizzard drew us off the place. And that's one of the venue lakes for the fly fishing, World Fly Fishing Tournament too. It's a beautiful, beautiful wilderness spot. Now, what we're going to do, I'm going to put a white feather on this thing. I'm going to get a nice one. This one, no, I don't like that one, this one. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take all off one side like this, look. Because if you don't, it will tie down to you. And you don't really want it to do that. It'll tie down and pucker up and all sorts of nasty things. Now take it down to right to the tip. Then, like on a shrimp do, you pull all these back. Like that. Just pull them back. Oops, don't pull them out of your finger and thumb though. Turn it round. Now the good side away from you and the dull side towards the hook again. Tie that in with at least that quarter of an inch you've got there. And stick it in your material clip out of the way. That's what that's there for. Now, body colours range from greens, browns, olives, olive greens and dark greens. And I netted one out of one of my favourite lakes, Pass Lake, and it was jet black. So any colour for these but the bright colours. There's no pinks, there's no blues, there's none of them colours. The natural hairy textures, like marl or weed, carrow weed colours. Now, tie it in, cover the bend. There's no tail on this one. Now come up to within an eighth of an inch. Tie it in, side by side, like that. try to make it pucker up a little bit so it looks a little bit fatter, although there ain't no fat flies. There you go. Now these live in this stage for most part of a year, and then they'll hatch off into the pupa and then come to that like little Dexheimer sedge, come to the surface, fly away, copulate, and that's another kettle of fish after that. Now, that alone, that body looks so real. Now, with your hackle pliers, I went away from me, remember? This time I'm going to come towards me. And this represents the fine hairs on the body of this little tiny worm that lives in the caddis case. So space it out. I tried to drop it where I can see the black thread on that chenille. Now it's got to get to the other end, Moses. Here we're getting there. I'm going to cheat a little bit here. Good. Now, bring this over and tie it down. Now, these worms do have a darker head on them. It can be light brown, it can be black, it can be dark green. Now, before I do anything else, I'm going to give it a haircut. Short, very short, like that. This sedge, I'm sure, if you fished in the estuaries where they do live, you could catch cutthroat, you could catch steelhead on it, you could catch anything on this fly. In fact, I do tie a steelhead one that is a big woolly worm, a big black woolly worm. Now, quite a generous head peacock hill. Chop off the chunks at the top there. Whenever you're doing anything on television, everything will happen. I've just got a piece of fluff up my nose. Just wrap this on for a head. As I said, last fall, the boys and I tied the flies and they begged them. And I'll get, you know what, for that, but they did. And you tie it in like that, and that is exactly what a woolly worm or a sedge larvae looks like. Exactly, hair perfect, size, diameter, and catches fish, which is the end product after all, eh? After you relax tying them, you're relaxing a boat fishing. You can fish it on, I caught most of them on a intermediate line, which goes, as it says, intermediate in the water. And then the leader took it down to where I wanted it on top of these weeds, where the sedges live. And the fish were feeding on them. At 20 fish on Bob's hooks, catch and release, I only killed two of them, in one afternoon at Tunkwa Lake. And they were ranging between 2 and 7 pounds. Now that's pretty good fishing for anybody. Now, stick that aside of this leech, this beautiful iridescent leech. The next one in my arsenal of flies is the shrimp, the freshwater shrimp. Now, if there's anything could be classed as bread and butter for, or fish and chips or steak and whatever you want to call it, for trout, it's this. They're there all the time. One pair of breeding shrimp can produce 20,000 in a breeding season. So that's why the lakes on the upper plateau in Kamloops area, and we've got a lot of them up there, are wall-to-wall carpet shrimp. Therefore, big fish. Simple as that. Without shrimp, if I know a lake hasn't got shrimp, I won't fish it even. There's not many lakes without shrimp. Now, green thread, wrap it on there like so. And you can put backs on these, you can put plastic bags on the back, you can do anything, any amount of these. You can tie an orange one. The orange one is a pregnant shrimp. She's carrying her eggs in a thoric pouch, which they are doing in my tanks right now. I must have 50 of them in the state of being very pregnant. Now, like on that other feather, I've stripped all of the right side facing me, the good side facing me. I've took all the right side off to the tip. And there's a couple more there that's going to come off. Hold it in the tip and pull these down. Just tease them down. You don't have to swing on them. There's a couple there that's going to come off too. Come off. And these are going to be the legs on a shrimp. Now, tie it with the good side, the dull side away from you. But we'd better put a tail on this shrimp, because shrimp do have tails. And what I'm going to do for a tail, like I did before, I'm going to pull off some big green stuff that I can't possibly use for anything else. I'll just pull off a generous amount. There you go. Pucker it up, So it just looks like a little tiny rudder sticking back there like that. And tie it in. And tie it right round the bend. Go down there, boy. Good. Excellent. This is one of my favourite. I keep saying that. I've got a box full of favourite flies. All these flies I've tried myself and caught lots of fish on them. Now tie this in like you did before, like on the woolly worm. And get back to the bend. I've tied two down there. Come out. Out. Do as you're told. There you go. Now put it in your material clip. Move it up here and get it. Now for a body. This green chenille, you can use dub body, you can use all sorts of wools, but I like chenille because it gives it that green texture. Somebody ravel this up just for me, I think. Let's unravel it. There you go. Simple. Take off the end like you did before. Just a quarter of an inch or so. Tie it in. And there you got it. Wrap it to within an eighth. And wrap it round like that, to side by side by side. Hump it up, make it look fat. There's no fat ones, but they do swim sometimes in a lumpy position like that. Retrieving a shrimp is a different kettle of fish too. You don't pull it in quarter of an inch poles, you pull it in 2 inch, quarter of an inch, 3 inch, 4 inch, 6 inch. Make it do anything it wants to do, because they can swim in any direction at any time. They're not limited to vertical migration or anything like that. Put a halfage on there, Moses, for good luck. And most time when I'm fishing this, I want to fish over top of a weed bed because they do like to hide. And I fish it with a sink tip with a 2 foot head on it, not a 10 foot, and fish it erratically. Now, towards you this time, wrap it in. There you go. Now, the legs on a shrimp are short, stubby, very powerful. And in between their legs are a set of gills that are moving all the time, which you really don't see. Not when you're looking at it sideways. So, now I'm going to drop another half inch on there because they like to come undone when I'm doing my next act. Gotcha. Now, tease as many down as you possibly can like that and really squeeze them. They'll go underneath. They'll follow that feather, and any that don't, of course, you've got the scissors. Do it to them. Good. Now the mile's too long, so I'm going to tie it off again. So that head's not quite big enough. Green thread. Gorgeous creature. Now we're not finished yet by a long way. You can put a plastic bag on, you can put a teal back over the back. You can put pheasant tail on the back. You can do almost anything for a back on this. Now take it out, shift it round between your finger and thumb. This is the only time, there's exceptions to all rules, that you're allowed to chop them off. Get rid of that fluff. Don't blow it into your scotch. There you go. Now tie it in again. Fasten it in. There's a couple more. What I like to do is just keep them clean of that barb. Now this one, as I said, you can fish on any line in any direction, from the bottom up, from the top down, wherever you like, because the shrimp are so erratic swimmers. They go up and down, sideways, straight down. I have a lot of fun watching them in my tanks. They put that on top of there like that. And that's what I would call the last in my box. There's variations on all the themes and variations in colours. As long as you keep the colours natural, there's no pink, bright blues or anything like that in freshwater. They've got to match their environment, like we'll show in the slide presentation. I've got a picture of a shrimp mounted in some carraweed, and you've really got to look for it, because it matches the carraweed perfectly. If it was, just to take a stupid point, if it was jet black like this vice, it would be picked off by every predator. So it's got to match its environment, and it will do. And it can change in a few minutes from green to yellow to marl bottom back to green again. It's only a blush on the outside. If you kill a shrimp, if a shrimp dies, it goes pink. So that means the texture of the colour of the body is just a camouflage to match its environment, like a blush. So there you go, folks, and that's all there is in fly tying. These are the flies that we've just tied from a period in time from ice off to ice on, and in the Kamloops area, the greater Kamloops area, where we have endless lakes of beautiful, beautiful rainbow. The time's come, folks, for something to happen that's not happened before, and that's catch and release on barbless hooks. Now, barbless hooks aren't a thing that you're going to lose fish. A barber's put on a hook to hold a bait on. Now, we've tied the bait on those flies as an attraction, as an insect that looks like an insect. So, pinch your barb down, grind it off, buy barbless hooks, whatever. And catch and release, if you do it correctly, it's quite easy. You just slip the hand under the belly of the fish, take the hook out, there's no barb on it, it'll come out quite easy, and the fish swims away for future generations. Because we in the Kamloops area have got numerous lakes that we can go and fish. And we've got also a generation coming up that wants to fish. So we're going to look after them. And catch and release and respect your wilderness, respect each other, and we're going to build a future for everybody to enjoy in the wilderness. And I thank you. And if I can help in any way, please contact me.